Okay, so welcome to the morning session. We have the lecture number 4 of Enrico Valdinoci. No, Enrico, please.
Great. So first of all, probably since some of you asked me, I should make some comment on the thing that I mentioned on the first lecture about the master equation, how to recover operators in divergence or non-divergence form from the master equation. So the exercise was to write a master equation with a spatial kernel and to put the right assumption to recover divergence and non-divergence forms operator. And so the way I was suggesting, for instance, is looking at an operator like this to recover the non-divergence case. You write u of x minus u of x minus y divided by m of x minus y to the power n plus 2s in dy. With the structural assumption that m of x minus y is equal to m of x minus y, which roughly speaking says that if you write this with x minus y equal to z, the operator charges x and z in the same way, so x and z are interchangeable if you look at the energy associated to this equation. Okay, and this operator, as s goes to 1, it recovers the operator in divergence form, di aij j. And if I'm not mistaken, the aij are like a constant that I forget, and then the integral over Sn minus 1 omega I omega j divided by m of x 0 omega n plus 2s. In the omega. And M is a matrix function. Let's say that everything is smooth enough to make the computation. The other possibility was to look at a slightly different form, but structurally very different. So I write something that looks like this, but it's completely different. And it's 1 minus s, the integral over Rn, u of x minus u of x minus y in dy. Right now, all looks the same. The difference is the matrix here that I put, that in this case is just m of xy, with the symmetry condition that m of xy is equal to m of x minus y. And now the situation looks the same or almost the same at this level, but the structure is very different because as s goes to 1, in this case, one recovers the operator in non-divergence form. And I think that aij up to constants that I neglect should be like okay, so the expression is the same formally, but the structure is somehow very different. Okay, and how to prove this? So let's say this is a divergence form, non-divergence form. So to prove the divergence form is more tricky, I think. One approach that is a little bit simpler is to look at the energy. So to notice that this condition induces naturally an energy function and pass to the limit the energy functional. But if you really want to pass to the limit the equation is a little bit more tricky, because if you pass the limit the energy functional, it's not completely obvious that the derivative of the functional in the limit is the limit of the equation. So somehow there is an exchange of limit that one has to check. If you just want to pass to the limit the equation, let me tell you what is a possible strategy. A possible strategy is, well, first of all, to notice something that is useful in itself, that is this formula, that if you have a function phi, which is positively homogeneous of degree, say, 2 plus alpha. Yeah? Yes, so somehow if you call x minus y z, okay, let's briefly discuss that. So you are saying you want to call it x bar. Okay, so let me erase this. Yes, x is a fixed point at this level and I'm integrating in y. But the idea is that if I look at the associated energy functional, what is the energy function you would guess from there is u of x minus u of x. Yes, 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 but I mean the only way I understand the condition is in the energy, in the energy functional. Okay, so if I call x minus y equal to x bar, it becomes then m of x bar, x, it's important not to miss the sign, so y is x minus x bar, I think, and this is m of x, and then it's minus y, which is x bar minus x. So if you exchange x with x bar, is exactly this. And the energetic nice thing that you get is that the functional that you would like to consider now becomes this. And now you see that x and x bar are charged somehow the same by the energy functional. So in a sense, the easiest approach to this kind of problem is to look at the energy functional. Oh, I forgot the 1 minus s. And pass to the limit the energy functional. Nevertheless, if you want to really pass to the limit the equation, it's also, I would say, an instructive exercise because it requires some computations that are always good to develop intuition. And in that case, okay, I'm not saying that is the most elegant proof that you can do, but one sort of straightforward proof is based on this observation. The first thing is that it's easier to just keep the right order in the Taylor expansion and just deal with homogeneous functions. So a little lemma that I think is useful in general is that suppose that phi is positively homogeneous of degree 2 plus alpha, say alpha bigger or equal than 0, then 1 minus, so this means that phi of tx is equal to t 2 plus alpha phi of x. And then you can compute explicitly expressions like this, of course, just by homogeneity, but just let me write it because I'm going to use it several times. Well, there is a factor that is probably 1/2, though I forgot the factors there, so it's not really important. So basically, okay, it's the same expression, but this integral is in Rn, and this integral is just on the sphere, and the rest simplifies by scaling, by homogeneity.
Not the one
by
Sorry?
The one by here, right? No, I think it's okay because you have integrated the rho to the, let me see if I show you the computation, right? Just plug the rho outside, then you...
It dies, okay.
So let me say to everybody why it dies. So I use polar coordinates. So if I use polar coordinates from the first integral, I have two integrals, right? One in the variable that I call rho, the radius, and the other that is the spherical average. I integrate the radius, and now the magic is that I choose, why I choose these exponents, because they must be the right ones. So I found them by trials and errors, of course. But these are the right ones for which the rho variable integrates, it kills exactly this factor, and the 2 comes because the factor that you get is 2 minus 2s rather than 1 minus s. But and then you are only finished with the spherical integral. Okay, so with this one can do the divergence form case. The divergence form case can be done in this trick, so I'm not really suggesting that it's the best approach, but it's still one possible approach. That is first to expand the u function. Expand the term u of x minus y, which is on the top of the integral, up to order y cube. Second, is it convenient in this case to fix x and call m of y to be the matrix at the denominator when we think of it as a function of y, and so expand m up to, again, order 3. Well, once you know m, you know the denominator. It's a little bit more painful, but it's the absolute value to some power of something that you know, so you know the first order, you know the second order, and so on. Then when you do things like this, you put everything in the formulas, you are patient enough, and you obtain somehow things that are positively homogeneous of degree 2 plus alpha, with alpha, I think, equal to 0 and equal to 2. And so what you get using, let me call star. Well, using star in the limit, you obtain something a little bit unpleasant, so one thing before, just to be very precise, in the Taylor expansion, I expand up to order 3, which means that I have also the gradient and the second derivative. While here, in principle, I don't have the gradient, so I have to subtract brute force from the equation. So use the map that sends y to nabla ux dot y divided by m of 0 y to the m plus 2s dot. And then use star. Then what you get, if I'm not mistaken, is something like up to constants. I made a little mistake in the sign of the operator, because for the way I wrote the Laplacian is the negative Laplacian. So if you do this, what you get is almost what you want, because it's like aij dij u plus bj uj with aij. Let me write it so that if you want to do the exercise, you have it. It should be 1/4 the integral over Sn minus 1 omega I omega j divided by mx0 omega to the n plus 2s. n plus 2, because you pass to the limit. And then you have bj, which is n plus 2 over 2, the integral over Sn minus 1, omega I, omega j, m0 omega I m0 omega over m0 omega n plus 4. Okay, which seems that we missed the point because we are not getting something in divergence form in principle. But now one uses the structural condition to check that BJ is actually the derivative of Aij with repeated index. Okay, so in a sense you can go, you can start backwards. I mean, you can have something like this and you ask yourself, what is the right condition I should put? The right condition that you want to put is something that recovers the divergence form in the limit. The other part is easier. Sorry. Yes, is that I'm always used to write n plus 2s that when I don't have an s, I will always make an error. Yes, and of course, let me say that the advantage of working in Sn minus one is that this guy is not singular anymore. You are just on the sphere. Oh, I didn't say, but I'm assuming always that M is a smooth and non-degenerate matrix, so the denominator only vanishes when the point is zero. So it doesn't vanish on the sphere. Okay, now the other part is much simpler. The other part is much simpler because you just expand the function up to the second order, and you use the symmetry of the symmetry required in the condition to subtract the first order. So somehow the non-divergence case easier. I would say it's easier because there is less structure, right? It's a miracle that Aij is the derivative, that Bj is the derivative of Aij. So it has to be easier in a sense the case in non-divergence form, because in this case you just use one in the divergence form. So expand U. Expand the matrix M. Well, you can also expand the matrix M up to order one, or the vector MXYY up to order two. And here you see that things have to be easier because you are not expanding to order three, so you are saving one order. Well, this, of course, I didn't know in principle. I just noted it when I did the computations. Now, the tricky part, as we did here, we have to add the gradient into the equation to kill the first order. And to do this here, the gradient that you have to add or subtract to the equation is this. If you want to do this, you have to check that this guy is odd. And the reason for which it is odd is exactly the structural condition. You see that the condition there says exactly that when I change y with one minus y, I get the same. And then use the positively homogeneity of the things. I think with alpha equal to zero, so it's really the easy case. And you get the result. Okay, so it's not particularly fun, but I think it's kind of instructive because it gives a flavor on how the master equation can recover subjects that we more or less know in the limit, and we sort of understand what is the geometric structure of the master equation, which reflects in the end into a divergence of non-divergence form. So it can also be a suggestion if one wants to prove something inspired by the divergence or non-divergence form case to understand what is the right structure to put on the general integral operator to have some hope to prove something. I don't know. I think that people call it master because it's the original equation, right? In a sense, the people who are skeptical about differential equations think that differential equations are too cheap because they just want to model what happens nearby. But the real equation, I think, right, the master equation, am I correct? The master equation is an integral equation because it takes into account all the interactions of all the particles in the world, averaged by a probability measure. So I think that the language comes from statistical mechanics. Yes, and in principle, when I wrote the master equation, I wrote it in space and time. And we wrote this huge equation, and we said, okay, but that's too hard. Let's make some cases, and the typical cases were the case in which the kernel was the product of spatial kernel and time kernel. This is saying that the probabilistic motion that drives the system is actually independent in space and time, that two variables are uncorrelated, okay? Well, this is a simplifying equation, and then another particular case that we treated was exactly the case of divergence and non-divergence form in the space variable, which in particular comprises the fractional Laplacian. Another case that we considered was the case of the regional fractional Laplacian that was just put in the right characteristic function in the expression of the kernel. And also, we comprise the case of the Caputo derivative, again, putting the right time kernel in the expression. And of course, there are much more, but this is just to give at least four concrete examples in which the master equation reduces to something that we know. And that's it. So in this sense, what I mentioned yesterday that we could try to study a bit is this topic of non-local minimal surfaces that Chavi has already very nicely presented, and he gave a lot of very beautiful results. I will try to do very few things but to do somehow all the details, okay? So we don't study much, but at least what we study, we try to know it. And so the first problem that I would like to address, as I was saying yesterday, is this Bernstein problem that tries to classify whether or not the minimal surfaces that are graphs, so I will call them minimal graphs, are affine. So for this, let me first recall the notation. So the notation that Chavi was mentioning yesterday is that there is a pointwise interaction between sets. So if you have sets X and Y in Rn, say that they are disjoint, and measurable, I will always forget about the measurability, then one can define let me call this big N rather than small N. You will see in a minute why. Now I don't remember what is the exponent. You put S or 2S here? Alpha, okay. Oh, excellent. So that, because, you know, there are two tendencies in the non-local minimal surfaces case. One is to call this exponent 2S, and the other is to call it S, which is kind of annoying, but Chai was very good in putting alpha, because in this way alpha goes from 0 to 1, and it doesn't create confusion with the S before. Okay, and then if this is in the interaction between sets, you have a domain omega, you have a set E, and you say that the alpha perimeter of E in omega is now the collection of all the interactions between E and the complement of E, which involve the domain omega. So it's this I alpha of E in omega with the complement of E in omega. Then there is the interaction of E in omega with the complement of E outside omega. And then there is the interaction between E outside omega and the complement of E. No, and the complement of E in omega. And of course, as you see, it's almost impossible not to make a mistake. If one wants to check that what it's written is correct, this should be the same if I change E with its complement. So whenever you want to check that you didn't miss any complement or you didn't put any complement where it was not supposed to go, then you can check that the alpha perimeter of E is the same as the alpha perimeter of the complement, as it should be because it takes into account the interaction of a set with its complement. So it's symmetric under the complementary operation. Okay, so one looks at alpha minimizers that are local minimizers of this functional among all the sets that are fixed outside omega and wants to study the properties of the minimizers of this object. Well, these objects were introduced by Caffarelli, Joffre, Savin, in 2010, I think. And they're very useful for many things. For instance, somehow are the limit interfaces of long-range phase transitions, and they naturally arise in the case in which one looks at cellular automata, for instance. There is also a paper by Caffarelli and Suganidis about this with this motivation. They naturally arise in geometric flows. There is a paper, for instance, by Imbert. And so on. Now, right now, what I would recall is that, as Chavi was mentioning, minimizers of the alpha perimeter have the property that their alpha mean curvature vanishes at boundary points. So suppose that E is an alpha minimizer in omega. Let me suppose that the boundary of E is smooth enough. I think that it is what is C1 beta with beta bigger than alpha, probably, or smooth enough. If I'm wrong in the exponent, just say smooth enough. Then take X on the boundary of E. Then the alpha mean curvature of E at the point X, which is defined to be the integral over Rn of the characteristic function of the complement of E minus the characteristic function of E, put it Y, divided by the kernel, This has to be zero. Okay, you may wonder why I put the characteristic function of the complement minus the characteristic function of E, because everybody would put the characteristic function of E minus the characteristic function of the complement. It sounds nicer. And you can do that because it would be zero anyway. But the fact is that you write it like this, then the ball would have positive non-local mean curvature. So it's nicer to have the intuition that something convex has a positive curvature, whatever it means. Okay. So the idea is to try to say something on objects which minimize the perimeter, the alpha perimeter, or on objects which have, for instance, zero non-local mean curvature and so on, or constant non-local mean curvature, more generally, as Chavi mentioned. Let me say that I put in brackets the fact that the boundary of E is smooth enough, just because I'm probably going to use this information today only for smooth sets. But the non-local mean curvature equation actually holds true in the viscosity sense, even if the boundary of E is not smooth. So this is just, if you like, a technical complication, a very non-trivial technical complication, but today I will probably just deal with smooth sets. And so the first result I would like to present to you. Sorry? Well, one way, for instance, to find the expression for minimizers is to integrate by parts these things, and you would get integrating twice. You will write this as in divergence form. You integrate by part twice, and you have somehow the integral on the boundary of E. And so whenever you make perturbation, you perturb from that, one of the two integrals goes away because it's the perturbation setting, and the other is exactly like this after one integration by parts. So another way of looking at these things is that you are taking averages of the normal. One way, maybe if Chavi remembers it by heart, is that one can look at the alpha perimeter of E in Rn, for instance, as a double integral of the product of the normal, right? And now I have to be careful with the kernel. It's what, n plus alpha plus 2? So plus 2 or minus 2? Maybe minus 2, right? Plus 2. No. Well, one of the two, but let's think about this guy has to come from the divergence of something. So the divergence, so this guy is minus n minus alpha, so should go to 2 minus n minus alpha, so should come in this way. Okay? But okay, let's say that this I'm doing by heart, so I may be wrong. Just double checks in the textbooks. But the idea is this, that somehow you are averaging the normal over the set, dividing by a kernel. If the set is smooth enough, you can take perturbation of this thing, and you arrive at the integral inside. You integrate back by parts the integral inside, and you get something like this. Okay, at least roughly speaking, this is the idea. Okay. So the first theorem I would like to present, something I've been doing with Alberto Farina. Okay, and so one thing is that I will look at graphs. So if I say that a set is a graph, I always mean is a graph in the last direction. So for this, it's convenient to write that big N is N plus 1. And if I say that E is a graph, well, this means that E is a subgraph in the last direction. So E has the form xn plus 1 less than u of x1 xn. And I sometimes will call this variable x and the variable big x to be x xn plus 1 as a point in Rn of the form r little n. Okay, so if I do this, I erase everything? Ah, just because I was here, because Francesco introduced me from here, and so it was easy to do this. It's not a political statement.
So he touched the blackboard at 90 degrees exactly when he hit the blackboard and then he moved back. Minimization problem.
Okay, so the result somehow says that minimal cones, I say that E is a cone. If it is homogeneous of degree one, in a sense, so if TE equal to E for any T bigger or equal than zero, that is, for any P in E and for any T bigger or equal than zero, TP belongs to E. And so the theorem I would like to present is a classification theorem of all the alpha minimal cones, so the alpha minimizers, which are cones that are also graphs. So suppose that E is an alpha minimal cone and the graph. Which means that E is of the form xn plus 1 less than u of x. And suppose that u is sufficiently smooth. Now, u cannot be, in principle, very smooth at the origin because the fact that E is a cone makes u homogeneous of degree 1. Because you put the t here, the t here, the t has to go out so that it simplifies. So we know that u is homogeneous of degree 1. Unless u is flat, it cannot be very smooth at the origin. So I will assume that u is sufficiently smooth outside the origin. With beta bigger than s, I think. Then E is a half space. Or if you prefer, U is an affine function. Okay, how how to prove this result. So well, once one knows the proof is not difficult. The idea comes from an old paper by De Giorgi, published in Annali della Scuola Normale di Pisa, in which it's one of the first papers on Bernstein problem. And so the rough idea is that one can look at the equation for E, which is this one. It has to write this equation in terms of U, take one derivative, and use the maximum principle to show that the derivative of U is actually a constant. So for this, so let me do first step is write an equation for U. Well, this part, of course, was not in the original De Giorgi approach because De Giorgi already had the equation. But here, the idea is that one has this guy and one can integrate this guy in the vertical coordinate. So somehow, my approach is this. I take a linear function, so I fix x on the boundary of E, and I take little x less than zero so that I'm in a smooth point, and I take the tangent plane at this point. So I take the graph yn plus 1 less than gradient of u of x dot y minus x plus u of x. So I have something like this. I have my graph E, and I have so E is somehow whatever is below this this line, and L is whatever is below the straight line. And so I can actually write that H alpha LX at any at the point X of the boundary is zero just because of symmetry, and then subtract it to H alpha V. This is just to be, I would say, on the hygienic side, because I'm somehow removing any possible singularity that comes just from the fact that I'm not looking correctly at the cancellations near the point X. So if I do this, from this fact, and the curvature prescriptions for E, and if I integrate by Fubini in the vertical variable, if I'm not mistaken, I have something like this. I have an integral with the condition that u of y is less than yn plus 1 is less than lambda u of x y minus x. Minus another integral in the reverse order of my kernel. The kernel I write is just once, but it's the same kernel. Then writing n as n plus 1. Okay. Now, this is a general observation. You are integrating this kernel with the last coordinate between two functions, So I think it's useful just to write what happens once and for all. So the real issue is to integrate yn plus 1 between two functions. I think I put, no, I put f here. And these are nice functions in the sense that when I compute y equal to x, I have the same value here and here. And this value is exactly u of x, which is my last coordinate. So somehow this means that I'm taking the right point. So if g and f has also this property, then you can write more or less explicitly this guy in this form. So it's an integral of r to the n, a variable that I'm calling here theta to the minus n minus alpha. Then I have f of the incremental quotient of the g minus the incremental quotient of the f. In the theta. And this f is the auxiliary function that was introduced by Chavi yesterday. I'm not sure we have the same normalization. Doesn't really matter, but what I wrote in my notes was just I'm integrating f from 0. You were integrating from minus infinity or, okay, from 0. I mean, the only important thing that you will see is that the derivative is 1 over 1 plus t squared to some power, which is a nice function decaying to infinity. And also, actually, the second derivative is a nice function decaying to infinity and so on. So somehow, the expression for f is very ugly, but the derivatives of f are much nicer than the function itself. Okay, so what happens is if you apply this to this u, so this f and this g and vice versa, then what you get, so you can apply the thing to f and g and vice versa, and you can actually change theta with minus theta when you do this. The equation that you get is the following. So the equation that you get, I'm calling it calligraphic f of u at a point x, is just the integral over Rn. Now, it's very important not to mess up the signs. Minus n minus alpha, fine. Then I have f of the incremental quotient with plus. Plus f of the incremental quotient with minus. I hope I did not mess up the signs. And you may wonder why the gradient disappeared. Well, the gradient disappeared because I'm writing this equation, and I get the plus theta part. Then I write the same equation changing theta with minus theta. The sign minus here will make the gradient disappear, and the part with the incremental quotient should sum up. Well, that's what should happen. So if you do this, the next step is, of course, to differentiate. So the first step was to write an equation for u. We wrote an equation for u. It's ugly. Well, it's what it is. And then differentiate the equation in some variable. So we fix a direction. And we look at the derivative of u. And we take a derivative of the equation to see what is the equation satisfied by v. Well, so the equation satisfied by v is the following. So it's what I call the linearized equation at u of v at a point x. Sorry, and this guy was zero, okay? This is the equation. And the equation for this is that the linearized equation is zero. So I write what this guy is. It's the integral over Rn. Now, it looks uglier than before, but you will see it's not that bad, minus n minus alpha minus 1. And then I have, let me do a very drastic thing. Let me erase everything, because I will need a lot of space just to write the equation. So I will use the blackboard up to there, but no panic. Things are going fine, hopefully. So this is f prime of the first incremental quotient that I wrote it with plus. And then I have to differentiate inside, so I get v of x plus theta minus v of x. Then there was a theta that I put comma factor here, because I will have the same here. I know that I will have the same here, that's why I put it comma factor. Then I have f prime of u of x minus theta minus u of x divided by theta. And then I have v of x minus theta minus v of x. And I was too optimistic not to erase also this part. Okay, d theta, and all of this is zero. Okay, I know you may not like this expression, but let me try to convince you that it's not so bad. So as I was saying, u is homogeneous of degree 1, which means that v is homogeneous of degree 0. So now the third step is use maximum principle on well, but consider, so this is not immediate, but so yesterday night I checked if u, yes, yeah, you may have to write this in principal value, this I agree. But nevertheless, when you arrive here, if u is c to beta with beta bigger than alpha, then this all this junk here is integrable. And if you only write one f, is a little bit worse, because there is a, somehow a cancellation that comes here from the fact that you have a minus when you look at this. Well, if f was the identity here is somehow the fractional Laplacian with the second order incremental quotient. Yeah, yeah, no, I agree, but at this level, I don't think that you even need the principal value, but at this level, you may want to put principal value. Let's say that all the integrals that I have, but also, if you want here, you have to put a principal value to start with. Why? So I thought it was safer to symmetrize it like this. But if you say that one could have been enough, well, I have to admit that I have this idiosyncrasy also to put the fractional Laplacian with the plus and then the minus. So also to write the second order thing. So it may well be that you don't need to symmetrize here. It just reminds me more the symmetric structure of the fractional Laplacian. It looks more a second order operator when you write it with the plus and the minus. But I agree. I mean, you will see the proof. And you will probably tell me, look, you don't need 2F because the proof works for one side and for the other in the same way. So, we are already over time. Yes, okay, so I apologize. I will finish this tomorrow. Okay. Sorry.
So do you have questions on this?